Hello, good evening and welcome to PM Express. It's Wednesday and it's Corporate Wednesday. Now, the minority in Parliament is taking with a pinch of salt strategies outlined in the 2013 budget to achieve a 9% budget deficit. Government is said to have overspent in excess of 1.8 billion Ghana cedis last year, accounting for 12% deficit. But why do ministries spend more than it's approved for them? A director in charge of forecasting at the Ministry of Finance blames it on lack of respect for the laws governing public spending. These are some of the things I will be exploring. The Speaker of Parliament is, however, advocating for a non-partisan approach to address the issue of budget deficit. The minority in Parliament says available records on the Ghanaian economy indicates that the country is back to hip-hop. How true is this, and what is the true state of the economy? So in the studio with me to have a discussion around the budget is, to my immediate left, Dr. Mark Esibe Yeboah, who is MP for New Jabing South in the Eastern region. And then next to him, I have Honorable James Kluche Aveti, who is chairman of the Finance Committee and is MP for K2 North. I keep saying K2 South. I beg your pardon. So, gentlemen, it's great to have you in the studio. Welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
So, let me start with you, Dr. Esibe Yeboah. What is the basis of suggesting that the country is back to hippie?
It's headed back to hippie.
I mean, yeah.
HIPIC is the acronym for highly indebted poor country.
Yeah.
Now, Ghana is a lower middle income country. So technically, we cannot be getting back to HIPIC.
Yeah.
Because what we are headed back to is HIMIC.
This is interesting.
Yeah,
highly that's a new one.
Indebted middle income country. You know, highly indebted middle income country. So we are sure because we are no longer classified as a poor country. So we'll be headed back to a highly indebted middle income country. Now, if you look at the numbers, they speak for themselves. Currently, Ghana's total debt is 33.5 billion Ghana cedis. 33.5 billion Ghana cedis. At the end of 2008, it was 9.6 billion Ghana cedis. So in a matter of 4 years, the debt stock has increased by 248%. That is, in just 4 years, we've added 24 billion Ghana cedis. Now, this debt does not even include the CDB Chinese loan that we are looking forward to receiving about $3 billion, making 6 billion Ghana cedis. So add that to this, and then you have maybe 40 billion Ghana cedis as our debt. Our debt stock as of now constitutes 49.4% of our GDP. So our debt stock constitutes 49.4% of our GDP. That stands at about 71 billion Ghana cedis. Now, according to the World Bank, the IMF, your debt gets unsustainable if it constitutes 60% of your GDP. So we are pretty much at 50% of GDP right now. Now, throwing in the CDB loan, and at this rate that the NDC is proceeding, where they are borrowing as though they were on steroids, you know, we will just reach the 60% mark in another 3 years. Then we are in Greece right now. We have sovereign debt crisis. So that's why we said the country is headed back to HIPIC, but technically HIMIC.
Yeah. Right. So Honorable Aveti, you've heard the explanations from Dr. Esibe Yeboah that the country is heading towards a highly indebted middle-income country, and the debt sustainability is gradually becoming an issue. If we cross the 49.9% GDP mark very soon, our debts will be unsustainable. These are reasonable comments, aren't they?
Thank you very much. I think that MPP is good at forming acronyms. First of all, they agreed that Ghana should go into HPIC when President Kufuor was the president of this country. Probably, they, if they should come to power at all, maybe they will take the
Ghana. Was it an agreement, or it was the economic reality of the time?
Absolutely.
I thought that the economic reality of the time meant that Ghana needed to subscribe to the highly indebted poor country in order to get some concessions, which we did as a country, and perhaps put,
well,
us,
but
on,
the first
put us on track to recovery.
The first thing remains that it was during the Kufuor time that Ghana went to HPIC. That was the reality at the time, that we need to subscribe to the HPIC initiative. And we did do that as a country under the leadership of President Kufuor. So whatever decision that could be taken at that time was taken by the head of state at that time. So that fact.
So if it was the NDC government, would there have been,
well,
a different,
I wouldn't have
decision?
Known, because it wasn't NDC at the time. So I wouldn't have known what would have been the situation. So just to say that probably they will take Ghana again to HMIC if they are good at forming these acronyms. Now, but I disagree completely with him by saying that we are heading towards HPIC or HMI, whatever he wants to put it. You see, you actually do not even look at the deficits, or we're talking about the debt profile, just say because we are getting towards the 60% debt to GDP, and for that matter, we are going to enter into HPIC or HMIC. Governments over the years look at whatever is available to government and match that revenue or that resources against the needs of government. Yes, we are middle, lower middle income country. Therefore, those concessional facilities we used to get previously will not be able to access them again. We have to go in for commercial facilities because we are middle income country. And if we don't go in for commercial facilities, we cannot develop our economy. Now, if you look at the total revenue generation for 2012, it was 16, a little above 16 billion. And salary alone take over 7 billion. Statutory payments in terms of health insurance, common fund, GET fund, take about 4 billion. Put the two together, it's about what? 11 billion. Then you come to interest costs of about 2.4 billion. You come to capital repayments, the principal repayment on loans, with about 4 billion. You put the two together, the 60 million is gone. We need to fix the road. We need to expand our revenue energy generation. We need also to build hospitals. If we don't go for any facility, how can we sustain as a country?
So that you are justifying the reason
spending
in excess of 1.8 billion Ghana cedis.
It's not about spending in excess of 1.1 billion. It's about, do we actually need those expenditure? Do we need them? If we don't need them, let's say as a country, we don't need to spend those money. And let's fold our hands and sit down. But if we need those expenditure, then we have to go and look for money and do it. Let's base it on individual basis. For me, the car I'm driving now, it was a loan I took from Parliament. And because I know that I have streams of revenue that will come over a period of year time, the bank was willing to give me that facility for me to go and acquire that asset, and I pay over a period of time. If I say that I don't have that kind of money, therefore I'm not going for any loan, will I own a vehicle that I'll use to do my work, to produce and be productive?
I mean, MPs can afford quite a lot of things.
No.
So if you use yourself as a
I'm just using myself because
benchmark.
I am affording a car.
You're
because
not poor.
I need a vehicle.
You're not even middle income. You're above middle income.
No, I need a vehicle to run, but I cannot afford that vehicle. So I went for a loan, supported by, backed by the government. Then deductions are made every month from my salary. Now, we apply this to the household. If you want to build a house and you don't have money to build a house within a year or two and move in, you can go for a facility and buy that house through mortgage system, then pay over a period of
time. So you're saying we shouldn't worry as a country how much we owe?
Of course. Is it?
I mean, if we owe 33.5 billion cedis, I mean, compared to what we owed
in just 4 years. Why should we be worried? Because we know that this year we have budgeted for revenue that we are going to realize. So it continues going.
Where is it
going
to come from?
It's coming from, that is the issue that we should talk about. What are the main, the principal, and the sources of revenue for this country? The traditional one is the tax. The issue that, for me, in the budget, I'm happy with that, revenue bills are coming to Parliament, where the minister is going to propose how we can raise more revenue from both formal and the informal sector. Now, I made an example the other day when I came here, that if a mason has a number of clients that he go and work for, let's assume that that mason earns 50 Ghana cedis a day. For a month, if he work for 24 months, he'll get about what, 1,200 Ghana cedis. Does he pay tax on this money? No. Doesn't pay tax because there is no system to track that he's receiving 550 Ghana cedis a month. So the issue about revenue generation is something that we, all of us as people of Ghana, to say, let's face it, how can we tackle the informal sector for them also to bring in the revenue? We should not behave that, oh, if government say we are going to tax the informal sector, that constituency, somebody, a party who said, hey, I'm going to take political advantage of that and make noise. Why are you taxing these people? Thinking that that constituency will be sympathetic to me when I'm standing for election, that constituency will vote for me because I'm fighting for them. Let's put that behind. Let's all face it. Because if you do that and you come to power, that same thing will come back to you.
Right. Let me shift the discussion to Dr. Esibeba. You seem to want to react.
I think my finance committee chairman is not addressing the key issue. At the levels that we are going, can we sustain that debt? We've seen it right now. If you go to Greece, there's a sovereign debt crisis. If you go to Spain, they're facing the same. Japan has gone through this. When you have these issues, you either develop these crises or it stagnates economic growth. Now you cannot keep on borrowing. He brings in the example of taking a loan. Now if you go to the bank to take a loan, they ask you to bring your pay slip. They want your repayments not to take more than 40%.
40%, yeah.
Yeah, they want you to stay under 40. If it's going over, then you would have to convince them.
You have doubts whether you can sustain your repayments.
Absolutely. Now, if in your household, you go to, let's say, Barclays Bank and you take a loan, you go to Echo Bank, you go to Fidelity, you go to GT Bank, now you'll be servicing all of these loans. So what you see is that at the end of the month, now you don't have anything to pay your kids' school fees. You can't buy food. So you cannot just keep on contracting loans and justify that, oh, because I need a car, you take a loan. Oh, yes, I need to own my own house. I take a loan. You have to look at the ability to repay. And that's what we coin as the debt sustainability.
Yeah.
So at the pace that we are proceeding, if we are not careful, that's why I said all these does not even include the Chinese loan. If you throw in the Chinese loan, we are at 40 billion already. And they are projecting to borrow some more. I'm worried. Now, if you break it down, where we are right now, every Ghanaian owes 1,340 Ghana cedis. Every Ghanaian owes 1,340 Ghana cedis of the debt. Now, you might say, okay, what are the implications thereof? The implications are that because of government's debt servicing, government doesn't have the fiscal space to fix the Sum in Sawam Road. Government doesn't have the space to give advance monies to VRE. That's why the doomsaw is going on. Government doesn't have the space to advance monies to Ghana Water to maintain their systems. So the public good suffers because of this overborrowing and overspending. So these are critical issues that we have to address. We cannot hide behind, MPP is criticizing, because if in 4 years, you add 24 billion Ghana cedis to the debt stock, at this pace, that's what my ranking member, Dr. Akutu Ose, said, the pace is faster than Usain Bolt.
But the MPP borrowed. MPP also borrowed extensively during the 8-year tenure.
But I took this dead
the
stock.
The economic situations were different.
No, the dead stock.
I agree.
But I give you the dead stock. So at the time of President Kufuor leaving office, the dead stock was 9.6 billion. And that 9.6 billion is not what was contracted by Kufuor. It was what was bequeathed to Buzia, Liman, everybody from independence. That was our dead stock. From 1957 to 2008, our total debt stock was 9.6 billion.
Honorable Abeji, you want to respond to that?
How much was the Hippic relief, the debt that was forgiven? He's not talking about that one. He's comfortable saying that they left behind 9.6 billion. Don't not knowing very well and knowing very well that.
But how much of that was Hippic relief?
I don't have the specific figure offhand, but substantial amount of money was forgiven. If that was added to the 9.6 billion,
it could have been higher.
Say. So that is not the issue.
That argument is flawed. Let me show you why the argument.
Okay, when you are talking, I didn't interject. So allow me.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
So that is the point. But the point I wanted to raise actually is that he was even supporting my position on the issue about the loan. No, if Ghana go to any market.
He was talking about debt sustainability.
Yeah, if Ghana go
and
to
whether
any market,
Ghana has the capability to sustain its debts. As a layman,
I will respond to you. If Ghana go to anybody to go and borrow, that entity will have to be sure that Ghana have the capacity to pay back the loan.
But that's not true.
Why is it not true?
Because a lot of the borrowing is domestic. Borrowing with the aid of the Bank of Ghana. Yeah. The Bank of Ghana financed 32% of the deficit last year. So a lot of the borrowing that we are doing is domestic.
He's just changing his position from here and there.
Is it? Is that a case?
A lot of the borrowing
and
we are
know,
doing...
We know that Bank of Ghana...
Is it the case that a lot of the borrowing
is domestic?
Is domestic.
Yeah.
Domestic, yes. That
has a serious effect.
No, that is the issue the current minister is going to address. That when you are debt financing, if you go together with the private sector to the domestic market, you will be siphoning the available funds, and therefore cost of borrowing and will be high for the private sector. We are aware of that one. If you go into the foreign sector, then you will be leaving the domestic funds available in the system for the private sector. We are aware of that one. If you say that one, I agree with him perfectly. But for the fact that we are going to borrow, it is because those people, those institutions, those financiers that are giving out this facility know very well that Ghana in the future has streams of revenue that is flowing in to be able to service the debt. That is what they are giving us.
So give me a prediction. Give me a fair prediction of what you think the outlook of Ghana's financial situation is going to be for 2013.
It's clearly in the budget. That
and what is it going to be?
In the budget in 2013, we are going to spend
less?
More. And the deficit will be 9%.
You are hoping to put the deficit at 9%. That's the projection.
Yeah, the projection.
You're projecting to stay within 9%.
Now you ask me why. It is because we don't have much revenue. If we have much revenue, we match it against our expenditure. And if the revenue is higher than the expenditure, we have surplus. But where in current situation, our expenditure demands is higher than the revenue collection. We will continue to have deficit until we take three main options or actions. One, we'll increase our revenue and maintain the level of expenditure or reduce the expenditure. That is one option.
But that's very basic.
Yeah, that's very basic.
That's very basic. But the question is,
can you reduce the expenditure?
Do we have the discipline to stick to these options?
That is the question. That what are the items that make up the expenditure total? Emolument in a budget for 2013 is 9 billion. For salaries, 9 billion. If we are going to generate 22 billion. And 9 billion is going for...
But if productivity is high and emoluments demands are high and productivity is high, it should pay for itself. isn't it? I mean, should government cite emoluments as challenges facing its economic management if it has not put in place the systems to ensure that productivity also increases?
No, you see, that is the problem we have as a country. If you look at the size of our workforce on the government payroll, it's more than twice the number. If you take UK, where Ghana's number of employees on government payroll is around 600,000 people, UK is around 350,000. The population of UK is 60 million. Ghana's population is 24.5 million. Yet our workforce is 66,000 or 600,000 people. Now, the issue is, what do we do?
I mean, what's the essence of the comparisons?
Essence of the comparison is that we have too many people on the government payroll.
So why? Sack some and make government
that ability is the question.
To pay minimal?
That is a question. Should we sack some and pay those people who will be left
but
on
you,
government
you
payroll?
But you tell me. I mean, but we're looking at the options.
It is an issue
of
that we should
ensuring
have a,
that
we
we'll stay
within debate. The... It's an issue that we should have a national debate.
Mm.
I remember in 2009, when government freeze employment for 2 years, the hula baloo that came after that. Why government don't want to employ? And I said, look, if you run a company that needs 20 people to run, and you have reached 20 people, do you continue to employ people more? If you do that, will the company be profitable? That is the situation we have reached now. Should we continue to employ people and add to the number now? Or we maintain the number we have now, or we reduce the number? This is something that we should discuss
as
a country.
What is it going to be for your government?
For now, we're maintaining the number. And the only thing that we'll be doing probably to be replacing those people who will be going on retirement and the rest. Replacing. So we maintain the number. And I think if we want to succeed as a country, we need to take pragmatic measure in our wage bill.
Dr. Esibe Eboa, you have an issue with this whole wage bill discussion,
yeah,
right?
Wages in Ghana are comparable to those in the sub-region. If he says that the workforce is large, I agree to some extent. So in the public service and the civil service, some trimming could be done. But you see, we cannot complain about revenues and the large workforce and then take our eyes off the spending. Mm. It's the spending that has gone crazy, if I may. Because if the way he talks about being prudent and our revenues are not enough, look at Ghana. We go around distributing laptops to university students, to polytechnic students, to people all over. Even in the United States, people don't get free laptops. Should we be doing that? That it's the spending that has gone crazy. If you look at all those cars that were bought, Chiefs, you call Chiefs, they buy them Land Cruisers.
But the MPP started the one laptop per child policy.
Listen, there's a difference. That laptop design is not the normal laptop, if you would recall. It was some laptop designed for children. That one you and I wouldn't be able to use. This is for the distribution now went to adults, not children, adults. I know faculty at tertiary institutions who were signing up, write your name, we'll give you a laptop. You give freebies as though you were a high-income country. So it's the spending that has gone crazy. Chiefs were being given Land Cruisers. People were being given pickups all over. You don't do that if you are a lower middle income country and if you have revenue issues. So it's the spending that has gone crazy, and that's what we have to fix. If you want to lower your debt stock, if you want to have small deficits, you do consolidation. This whole idea of fiscal consolidation is reducing spending. So that we have it. Now tell me, if you have 6 ministers of state at the presidency, one in charge of scholarships, is that prudent fiscal management? What are they doing at the presidency? 6 ministers of state, a whole minister of state in charge of scholarships. So tell my advice to the government is to look at the spending side. Cuts, 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 cuts. You go to Eco Brigade. You know Eco Brigade? There are guys who walk along the beaches, supposed to be cleaning the beaches. It doesn't make sense. Now, there's filth in town. You are cleaning the beaches. Where does the filth come from before it gets to the beaches? The wind blows all of
that. Are you saying that cleaning beaches...
It doesn't make sense.
Does it make sense?
No.
That you should leave the beaches filthy?
But how about the home, our surroundings, where we live? It's filthy. That one you don't care, but you pay people to go clean the beach. Do you know what happens? They have ghost names. SEPA says we paid 1.2 billion Ghana cedis to ghost names. They line up people under programs, JIDA. Then they pay them monies as food soldiers. Those are the issues we have to confront.
These are wild allegations you're making.
Yeah, definitely. They are allegations. In fact,
I said Echo Brigade, we don't need it. Is this an allegation? I say that all the six ministers of state at the presidency, it doesn't make sense.
That is a huge sums of money are paid to ghost names who are for soldiers. That's an allegation.
The people who work in the Echo Brigade, the people who are hired to work as Echo Brigade are party faithfuls. And if the whole program doesn't make sense, it means you are throwing money away. So these are not allegations. These are facts.
So, Honorable Aveji, I mean, I'm concerned about fiscal responsibility. I mean, there is a call for fiscal responsibility to control government spending. How do you think? How do you think that will address the deficit?
Well, one issue about the deficit is that, as I said, we have to look at the expenditure side as well as we look at the revenue side. The budget made provision for how we'll be raising revenue through the revenue bill that will be coming to Parliament. And then also the government also make some proposals in how expenditure can be reduced. But there are expenditures that definitely little government can do about them. And one of them is a compensation. If you look at the projection for 2013, the compensation of employees is 9 billion Ghana cedis. Then, if you come to recurring expenditure, goods and services, it's only 1.7 billion. For goods and services, it's only 1.7 billion. So, it means that government is making all effort to reduce the expenditure side of the budget. Even with that one, the total budgeted expenditure, if you add all other statutory funds like health insurance, get fund, common fund, and the rest, and then interest costs, and then the principal repayment, the total budget for expenditure is 28 billion Ghana cedis. While the total revenue expected is 22.5 billion Ghana cedis, giving a difference of 8 billion Ghana cedis. That is what is going to make sure that we have 9% deficit. Now, if this is followed strictly, it means that we will achieve that target of 9%. Now, all this effort that we made.
You're speaking as if 9% deficit is a cool thing.
No, it's not a cool thing. That is what the point I was coming up with. We cannot, and it can never happen, that we had 12% deficit in 2012, and therefore we should have 0% in 2013. It can never happen.
Nobody has called for 0%.
It can never happen. So it should be a gradual process. As you are pushing the revenue side, make sure that you target all people who
forward
earn
in the
revenue,
income brackets,
who earn income
bring
in Ghana,
in, rope them in, tax
income that
more.
Is brought into Ghana, income that they receive in Ghana or generated in Ghana. These are four main sources of taxable income. These people, we tax all of them. The informal sector, the formal sector. Then as we are raising the revenue side, we'll make conscious efforts to reduce the expenditure side. And that one, those areas that are for the minister to play with are probably only the goods and services. So we don't want a situation where we will collect revenue, pay workers, no tools and resources to work with.
Does it look like the let me put that to you, Dr. Sibi. Does it look for you that the current government has solid plans to rein this economy in, to effectively bring down the deficit and put the country on a good footing?
Yeah, when you project a 9% deficit, it doesn't send good signals to the outside world.
I mean, the developing partners are not too excited about
besides,
deficit
besides,
situation.
When you go, that's why Fitch has downgraded our credit rating to B+ negative. When you go back to the foreign markets to borrow, now you're going to pay higher interest. So, in effect, our interest costs that we are complaining about in this year's budget, interest payments alone, 3.1 billion. Interest payments. Ghana cedis. 3.1 billion. That's just interest payments. Now, these are going to build up and build up. I said the solution to this is looking at the spending side. So the minister and the president should be going to the ministries. Any frivolous spending, you just cut it off. Like here, you work here. Your bosses, they trim down the spending. You know, I'm sure maybe previously we were giving folks coffee or something, but now you've cut that one. When we came in, you didn't even give us anything, you know. So you go around and you cut all spending that you think, oh, this one, we don't need this. I'm not seeing that in the budget. We are projecting to spend in total 31 billion. That's the projection for this year. So from the get-go, you are like, okay, I'm going to do 9% deficit. The deficit will be
the
more than.
Is 28 billion,
no, no, if, no. In total, I'll show you.
Go to pay.
I'll show you. I'll show you. The appropriation that is being. Have you forgotten arrears? The appropriation that we are going to pass 31.8. Go to page 273. Appropriation is 31.8. There's arrears. We haven't even talked about arrears. So every year, apart from what is budget, then there's arrears from the previous years. We have to do some more cutting.
Well, we have to do some more cutting. That's from Dr. Marcus Ibeyeboah. My name is Stephen Enti. You can join us by text 1760 or post your Facebook comments on our Facebook walls, facebook.com/joynews. If you are on Twitter, our Twitter handle is Joy.
Welcome
News
back to PM
TV
Express,
and we're discussing issues about the budget and Ghana's projected revenue and deficits, etc. I have with me in the studio, as you already know already by now, Dr. Mark Ibeyeboah, who is MP for New Jabing South in the Eastern Region, and James Kluge Aveges, Chairman of the Finance Committee. So, gentlemen, before we went on the break, Honorable Aveges, you wanted to respond or react to something that
Dr. Ibeyeboah
was saying.
The issue that my colleague is raising about government must cut expenditure. Government must cut expenditure, but to what extent can government cut expenditure? If you take the total expenditure that government want to incur in a year. We take 9 billion for emoluments. You take 3 billion for investment item. You take subsidy, which is 1 billion. You take
statutory payments.
I don't have that figure. I can't see clearly. If you add up all, little is made available for other goods and services. Now, here the goods and services is 1.7 billion. If my colleague is saying that government must cut, probably government must cut the emolument expenditure. Government cannot
cut. That's why we need fiscal discipline, isn't it?
Fiscal discipline can only apply to those discretionary expenditure that is available for the minister to give to the ministry.
So what you're saying that less we can cut.
The statutory payment.
Then the 9% deficit projection is not going to be achieved.
No, it will be achieved because it is based on these figures. That is why we have the 9%. And I'm saying that if we go strictly to the projection that we have in the budget, then we will achieve the 9%.
Yeah,
now we can only go beyond the 9% if we spend more than the figure available for goods and services, if we go beyond that. But if we go within that figure, we'll achieve the 9%. So probably we'll cut the personal emolument.
But I'm going to show you cuts in the budget.
Where? Show me.
Item 28. You have
which page?
Where you are 273.
273.
Item 28. We have other expenditure. There's a reserve expenditure vote, like what you call contingency or miscellaneous. Mm-hmm. You know,
of how much?
Guess what? 726 million Ghana cedis.
726
million Ghana cedis.
Yes. Good.
Okay.
That's a lot.
Yeah. He says, I'm showing you cuts. Acquisition of non-financial assets. Now, they promised that they are going to build 10 new teacher training colleges. It doesn't make sense. Now, see, already there are 38 teacher training colleges. They take in 9,000 students every year. Under Kufuor, they made expansions. So now they have applied to the ministry that, can we increase our intake to, let's say, 12,000, or we can even go to 15,000? The ministry says no, because when you bring in students, we have to pay them allowances. We don't have the money. And then now you tell me you're going to build 10 new teacher training colleges. Do we need those? Whilst you are not ready to even increase the intake in the existing ones. So you can make the cuts. But if for populism and for political capital, you want to go build teacher training colleges, you see, that's how come you incur these deficits. So some of the expenditure, it doesn't make sense.
Probably my colleague in New York himself, all the schools we have, there are a set of teachers that
are in
schools.
Talking of teacher training colleges.
Yes, definitely. The teacher training
but we
colleges,
can increase
what are
the
they
intake,
going to do?
We can increase the intake right now in the existing ones.
Why? How?
Didn't I
explain? Can we not?
How can we do that?
Tell me why we cannot.
There's a quota. All teacher training colleges in the country.
That is a problem with
only
MPP.
Only 9,000 students every year.
That is a problem with MPP. Where they increase the 4 years, 3 years senior secondary school to 4 years.
We are not addressing the specific issue of whether the training colleges can increase their intakes.
They have applied to even go to 15,000 from 9,000. Like the training college in my constituency, SDA training college, they can only take 270 students every year. They have space for more, but they have not been given the permission to do so. So why don't you increase the intake there? You can take in 6,000.
I don't
6,
buy that. Yeah,
you don't
because,
buy this is fact.
I don't have that fact. Okay. And I don't think this is something
what,
that is
true. So what facts do you
then,
have?
Then you tell me you are going
the
to build 10
The fact is that
the
government
want
to build
colleges.
Additional
infrastructure
for teacher training colleges so that we can train more teachers.
The space for 6,000.
Then
6,
we can have teachers to man our primary schools and basic schools. If it's telling me that we have the existing teacher training college can have more intake, it's a news to me. I don't have that.
Oh, is it news? Even today, Professor Fobi raised it on the floor.
Well, that is you. It's only you that's your side that have then, those informations.
Okay, anyways.
Right, let's move the discussion on. So, Honorable Aveji, tell me, what happens when the Chinese development loan, CDB loan, comes on board? What will happen to all our ability to stay within good fiscal deficit and borrow less and, you know, expenditure and all the things that we're discussing? What happens if the Chinese loan comes on board?
The Chinese loan is a project loan. It is a loan that will be disbursed within a period of 3 years. And whenever the project has been assessed and awarded to contract and certificates are issued, then payment will be made. So in the first place, it does not mean that the $3 billion will be transferred from China to come and sit in Ghana.
But it will add to the public debt, right?
It will add to the public debt over a period of time. Hmm. It
over,
will add to public
over three
debt
years.
Over a period of time, over 3 years period. It can even run up to, in fact, the facility was between 3 and 5 years for disbursement period. So those projects that run for 5 years, disbursement will be made in 5 years. So let's take the upper part. It means that $3 billion will be added to the public debt within a three-year period. And with that period, look, even the GDP for Ghana for 2013 is projected to be 88 billion Ghana cedis. So the base is expanding. So debt to GDP ratio will keep changing. You understand? So you don't just take a figure at a point and then assume that, oh, we have contracted this amount, therefore let's add it to it and then come out with the figure. He even made a point that every Ghanaian owes 1,400 Ghana cedis. I don't even know how he calculated the figure.
We are 25 million.
Yeah, 25 million.
So 33.5 billion divided by 25 million. Where
it's not 1,400.
Oh.
Use your calculator and do it.
33?
Yes.
0.5 billion.
I have a calculator.
Yeah,
we can do it right
33.5.
I think, I mean, we should just move on to
the substantive discussion at hand.
We're talking about how the Chinese loan will add to the public debt profile. And then tell me, why hasn't the Chinese loan been disbursed yet?
Oh, as I said, it's a project loan. As and when a project is executed, certificates are issued, then payment will be made to the contractor. In fact, that money will not come in and sit in our account.
Well, none of it has been disbursed yet.
No, they have started disbursing for the gas infrastructure.
Have they?
They have.
Have they?
They have started.
I don't think so.
You, That is why, mm-hmm. even if you look at the petroleum revenue report, uh-huh. there is a portion of 100 million Ghana cedis.
So has that been added to our debt stock?
No, no. Yeah. I just want to show you what is it? I think page 12 or 100 million dollars, 100 million Ghana cedis for amortization of loan.
Because my understanding is that there are problems with the Chinese loan. That's why the president sent the minister to China about 3 weeks ago. They're having issues with the Chinese loan because the Chinese will not just give monies to you. You really have to prove that these projects are viable and are going to repay for the loan. So there are issues with the Chinese loan. As far as I'm concerned, I hear if we are not careful, the loan might not crystallize. Yeah.
Okay. So if you can't find it, maybe we should just move
it on. Let's go. I'll
find
it.
Let's go on. So tell me what is the plan for the current energy and water situation in the country when it comes to investment into that area? What really is the plan
for the investment into the solving of the problem?
Yeah.
The current, I think that even the State of the Nation address, the president addressed that issue. And then gave out how the loss capacity in terms of generation will be brought on board. According to the president, by April and May, the West Africa gas pipeline problem will be solved, and therefore the production from Abuazi will come on board. I think about 250 megawatts will be added to the current generation, which is about 1,680. Then also, by the middle of this year, Bui, one of the turbines, will also come on board, producing about 130 megawatts. And then by the close of the year, the remaining two will come on board. So the full, or let's say, over 300 megawatts will also come on board. So that is a plan to solve the problem. But there is also another problem that we should all be thinking about, because our demand for energy is growing between 7% and 10% annually. So it means that if all the problems that the capacity we have now are all in place, which will come to about 2,500 or getting to 3,000 megawatts, we should have a plan of producing more power. That is why even in the last parliament, there was a power purchase agreement that was signed between government and some independent power producers to produce more or to generate more power through thermal plants, so that we can fill in all those shortages. So I think I'm not an expert in that, but the little that I've learned about, I read about that, this is the immediate plan to solve the power problem. But I think we need to do more, and that is another issue. If we cannot even have enough revenue to solve, to pay our workers and pay wages, goods and services, what do we do? We have to go and borrow again in order to produce more power to feed this country.
Honorable Ezibe, do you get the feeling that we're in full grip of, one, our country's expenditure, two, our investment in core areas like energy and water?
Yeah, I think sometimes governments have to be sincere with the people. You would recall that in the run-up to the elections, the president had promised that by the end of September, the energy crisis will be over. So that's an act of God, you know. Now we are being told a different story now. Because if the act of God has been fixed, then this crisis should be over. Now it's a matter of the demand for power being increasing at an increasing rate. So we have to make more investments into our energy sector. Now, so like you go back to ask, why, if you don't have enough power generation, why do you go distribute vehicles? Why do you go distribute laptops? You see, you have to build those infrastructure.
You seem to be very concerned with
that.
Distribution of laptops.
Yeah, but if you have critical investments to make in your water sector, in your energy sector, you are doling out freebies as though you are.
Tell me what the MPP would have done different. I mean, considering if we have we had a 12% deficit and then we're trying to rope in spending
if the MPP had been in government.
Yeah, I mean, what would you do different with the current situation on our hands?
That's what I'm telling you. On the deficit side, we would have brought deficits down to 5%. Matter of fact, if we were with a fund, if we ran to the IMF right now, Ghana. That's where they'll push us. We know the solutions to these problems, but if we are pushed, when the NDC came into power in 2009 and they joined the fund, the IMF, they went for a three-year program. And so when the IMF people left by July of 2012, then everything went berserk. So what we would have done if we were with the fund, why don't we do it if they are not here to be giving us conditional?
So you would have projected 5%?
5% deficit.
And that would have been very tough.
Yeah.
That would be...
That's what I said. If you are confronted with such a mess, now let in your own household, if you incur debts all over, then you have to stop eating outside at restaurants and the rest. You know, when we were in college, it comes a period that you have to cook. Maybe you might not like cooking. So you have to consolidate. That's what we would have done first. President Kufuor envisaged all of this. That's why he started the Bree Dam project, you know, a visionary leader. Now, we are being told 133 megawatts will come on board by the end of April. Hopefully, by the end of the year, all 400 megawatts will be available. So we have to make those critical investments in those sectors and stop things that are not permanent. You know, when you go give these cars, Land Cruisers.
The Chinese loan is not part of the debt.
Anyway.
It's the Chinese loan.
For the Bui Dam, it's part of the debt.
Is it part of it?
Yes.
Has it been used? Has it been disbursed for the Bui
Dam? That has been disbursed. And in fact, we have to even go for additional to complete the project.
Right. So, I mean, let's talk about Parliament, the Parliament and its role. I mean, do you think that Parliament is living up to its oversight responsibility of checking public spending?
Well, I think that
you are both members of Parliament. So
yeah, I have been in Parliament for 8 years. I'm my ninth year. He's my five junior. I'm older than him 8 years. I think that we have been doing our best. There are kind of logistical challenges. I think those are also being addressed now. You come to Parliament, you see members of Parliament do not have offices, and so those challenges are there. But we are trying, but I cannot see that we are actually holding the executive to
the proper check.
So I believe strongly that when the resources are provided for members, we'll be able to do better than what we are doing now.
Okay, so Dr. Sibiebo, I'll give you a closing remark.
I thought the chairman was going to make some serious commitments. But he's the chairman of the finance committee, and a lot of agencies are under the finance committee. For instance, the Bank of Ghana has to make semi-annual reports about our foreign exchange dealings. I don't think the Bank of Ghana does that. So he, as chairman, has to take the lead. I'm on the committee too. But when it's all about oversight. So once you send a note to hold any minister or any agency before, they will come. But if it's the chairman that has the power to do so. So I trust that. He sees that I'm concerned about reining in spending, so I trust that he'll take the lead. And then, with the little resources that we have, we still have to do our best.
Your closing remarks, sir.
Yeah, I think that the issue about is Ghana back to HIPIC? The question is no.
HIPIC.
Ghana is not back to HIPIC. I'm reading what I have on the screen. Ghana is not back to HIPIC. The country microeconomic. Position is very stable.
The indicators are good.
Really? To be frank with you, the indicators are good. If you look at what is happening in Ghana, and even take a country like Finland, even though they even have their debt to GDP over 100%, we are still below 50%.
But we cannot be comparing.
We don't have the infrastructure that we have.
We cannot be comparing like that.
Yeah. So I think that we are not HIPIC. We are not near to HIPIC.
We're not HIMIC also.
But I think that we should all prepare our mind as country that let's play our role. The little that I need to contribute so that Ghana can survive, we do that.
Thank you very much, Honorable James Kluche Aveji is Chairman of the Finance Committee, and Dr. Marcus Ibeyeboa, who is MP for New Drabbing South in the Eastern Region, is also a member of the Finance Committee. My name is Stephen Enti, and thanks for making time with us here on PM Express Corporate Wednesday. Join us again tomorrow for another edition. Good night.